But the most important introduction we need to make right now is this man to my right, your left, our driver, Gilbert. Let's give it up for Gilbert, our driver. Let me tell you something. First fun fact of the day, okay? Without Gilbert here driving us around, it's a long walk. A really long walk. Like a Lord of the Rings style long walk everywhere. Consider this our giant eagle. Right here. But they should probably take it in the first place, but that's a discussion for another time. We're about to just begin our journey today, guys. Before we get to the really fun stuff, all that fun informational stuff, I do want to make sure you guys know a couple things for your safety, all right? There may be times or maybe moments when you see either Tony or myself standing while the vehicle is in motion. Yes, with flair. We're trained professionals. You guys are irreplaceable, though. We made our peace with the fact that we're replaceable. You guys are irreplaceable to us. Please remain seated when this vehicle is in motion, as we will be encountering some sudden trolley movements on our journey today. In addition to that, we also will be encountering some loud noises, fire effects, and water effects. Watch out for those water effects. We have plenty of them on our attractions on the tour, as well as our rides and shows in the theme park. Just be mindful of that with regards to your cameras. We do want you going back to as many great photos and videos you can get a hold of today. And by the way, whenever we're driving around like we are right now, you're afraid we might pass something by, you want to get a shot of it really quick, just get our attention. This usually works. Hey, Owen. Hey, Tony. Hey, Gilbert. Get our attention. If it's safe to do so, we will stop. We will slow down. We'll make sure you get that perfect photo. Also, the name shouty arm wavy thing. That'll come in handy if any of your belongings falls off the side of the vehicle. If you're on the outer edges here, just be mindful that the windows go all the way down to hip level to pocket level. Just be mindful of that. If anything falls out in transit, let us know right away. If Tony or myself are on the mic, even if we're telling the most compelling, most interesting story ever, just interrupt us, please, so we can run out and go get it for you. If we have to run too far to go get it, I'm only going to speak for myself, but if I have to run too far to go get it, come back on mic, I'm huffing and wheezing, it's kind of embarrassing, so just let, don't wait for a lull, no. Let us know right away. And I think that should just about cover it. You're now seeing a little bit of our history as we head down the hill here. On either side of us, we have this collection of movie posters representing some of the classics we made here at Universal throughout our 100-year history. You might start seeing some of your favorite Universal movies represented. I always thought my personal favorite is written right here on my name tag, and that is Animal House. We got any Animal House fans here?
Woo!
Excellent. It's the movie that inspired me to go to college. I owe a lot to that movie and the studio. It's true. Tony, what do you got on your name tag? Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein. Great movie. Best of both worlds. Comedy, horror. I have legends all around in that one. Oh, yeah. But now, we're about to make our way into the front lot of our studio, folks. This is where we have our 28 sound stages. Now, a sound stage is a virtually soundproof warehouse where we can bring to life classic movie moments. In fact, the stage coming up here on the left-hand side, that is Soundstage 12. That is the largest soundstage on our property. Currently in use for The Voice, a great vocal competition reality series. You got a fan there. That's a fist bump. Yes! Look for fan reactions whenever we name drop productions. There's a fan right there. You see the paint job on the side of the stage for The Voice right there on the left. Stage 12 has been with us for some time, though, and as such has been home to some other classic movie moments. All of these scenes are filmed inside of Soundstage 12 as well. Those scenes for all those productions right there inside of Stage 12, and on your screens, that's what the inside of Stage 12 looks like when it's ready to go for filming, but this is what it looks like before we do anything to it. Nice, big, and empty. A lot of hard work goes into building those amazing sets inside of our stages, which are 98% soundproof. Comes in handy, because once those cameras start to roll, you have to be real quiet on the sets. You don't want to interrupt the take. The director kind of gets mad. Don't ask me how I know that. There's no story behind that none whatsoever. Anyway, here on the right, you're going to see the Verna Fields building. It's one of the last stops for productions. That's where we have all of our editing bays, all of our editing suites. Assemble all the footage in the right order, the right sequence, make it the most dramatic, most hilarious, most compelling, action-packed film or TV production we can. It's named after Verna Fields, a very famous editor, Academy Award-winning editor. She won for a little movie you guys may have heard of called Jaws. You guys heard of that one? Yeah. If you ever wonder why the movie is so scary, Verna Fields is a big reason for that. She assembled that footage in just the right way to make it so absolutely terrifying. Right combination of elements right there. Fantastic editor, John Williams doing that terrific score that we all know and love. Steven Spielberg's masterful direction, great actress. Just the stars aligned on that production for sure. Now, we do have another soundstage coming up here on the right-hand side. It doesn't look like the other ones, though. It kind of looks like a really fancy upscale apartment complex, this big white building here on the right. That is Soundstage 1. It is our newest constructed stage there. It's our live audio stage. That's where, a couple years back, Conan O'Brien filmed his run of this night show right here inside of Soundstage 1. Jimmy Fallon sometimes visits this year for about a week or so. This is his run of this night show here. That was about a month or so ago, wasn't it, Tony? Right out here. Super Bowl week, got it. And Soundstage 1 has also been home to shows like Chelsea Lately, starring Chelsea Handler, Hello Ross on the E! Network. Also, Last Comic Standing did a little film in there. But you guys want to see inside of the soundstage today, don't you?
Yeah.
I had a feeling, I had a hunch. So that's what we're going to do first, guys. Our first VIP excursion is to Soundstage 3. This is where they're filming a brand new show for NBC called Heartbeat, starring Melissa George. It's a medical drama series. We're going to pay a visit to one of their sets. Tony's going to be kind enough to show us around here. Bring your cameras, take as many photos and videos as you like. One thing the production has asked of us, though, please no touching anything once we're inside. You might think a wall is sturdy enough to lean against. I wouldn't. They're not as sturdy as you might think. But Tony's going to tell you all about that. Watch your step as you exit. Leave your bags, if you like, just on the floor by your seats. But definitely bring your cameras and follow us.
So it's about 98% soundproof, so we're talking about 18 inches. Those are called elephant doors. They have to be big enough for an elephant to walk through. There's no standard, you know, just big enough for an elephant to walk through. So every sound stage, no two doors are alike. They're all custom jobs, and the workmanship on these were, you know, back when people knew how to make stuff. So very little maintenance on these doors. They get worked on, and then they don't need any TLC for decades. But we have our guys at the metal shop. Every so often, maybe twice in their career at Universal, they have to do some sort of a touch-up on there. But we're pretty oblivious to the outside world. The only sound that can sneak in is if one of the big trucks, fully loaded, speeds by where we were driving. If they're going at more than 10 miles an hour, the ground will rumble a little bit, and the sound will carry here. And on rare occasions when we have those powerful Santa Ana winds blowing, sometimes the planes heading to Burbank Airport have to be rerouted. Unfortunately, they are rerouted over the park where we were walking. Basically around where Harry Potter and the Simpsons is, they have to basically fly over a turn and then swoop down that hill with the movie timing. And they will go right over here, and the rafters will shake a little bit. Otherwise, we're pretty oblivious to the outside world. Those are really high-end LED lights, and we have a cyclorama that hangs on that silver rod that's basically a giant curtain with a photo on it. So imagine a shower curtain and you print a real photo. We have the technology to do that now. In the old days, we had to make paintings because the pixels would never be big enough. I mean, the pixels would be too big, the pixels would be like a fist. And then the walls, here's a good example. These are wild walls. You can see they're not very thin. They're about as thin as cardboard, but then they're sturdy with this, what I call the waffle pattern. Then you can put in doors and windows, but that's what the walls are primarily made from. Come on down this way. Let's go inside the lobby of St. Matthew's Hospital. On the show, the show is taking a little break. They're utilizing the steps from the stuff right now. The show just started airing last month. They've been shooting from the summertime. They shot 5 episodes. Melissa George was pregnant, so when she started showing, they had to take a little break. And then they resumed after the first of the year and shot the remaining episodes for the season. So you can now see it on NBC, or go to nbc.com or on demand. And the show is set in Southern California.
So the view is a continuation of this building on one side and a beautiful blue California sky. And they have the view for the daytime scenes and the nighttime scenes. So it looks great. What do you think of the set so far, just walking in? What are some of the adjectives you might use? Big.
Kind of cramped
up. Yeah. As sets go, this is pretty big. Yeah, and it's still cramped. You put it on TV, this looks much bigger. That walk from the door to the stairs seems much longer.
Yeah.
But remember, the camera sees things two-dimensionally. Mm-hmm. Fortunately for you as a viewer, the camera is also high definition now. Your TV sets are not this big, they're this big, so detail is very important. So you can read all the names very clearly here if you wanted to. The names that you have, you know, as the donors for the hospital, these are actually people who contribute to the show in some way, shape, or form. So they get their names in there. So people who are not on camera can get somehow involved with the production. This is how you do it for a hospital show. If it was a crime drama, some of those creative people that work behind the scenes, they might be in the wanted posters. If it's something like a CSI, they might be cadavers. If they're not in a scene where you see them die and then you see them on the slab later, if it's just, is this your husband and there's a photo, that might be somebody who works behind the scenes, somebody involved with the crew. Gift shop. Everything in there is a prop. By definition, a prop is anything not nailed down to the floor or wall. What's that?
Are they glue on it?
No. You could, if you wanted to go in, I'm sure you could pick up a teddy bear or a flower.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no. And you want it to change. If we come back next season, I am sure that in the fall, it will be themed fall. As we get closer to Halloween, you'll see some Halloween stuff. As we get closer to Christmas, you'll see some Christmas stuff there. So we don't have to say, hey, it's December. No, stuff like that will tell you it's December. Looking outside, we don't have a change of season, so it'll be stuff like that that can tell you the time of year. You don't need the actors to tell you that. You should just have the settings do that work for you. Just like daytime or nighttime. If you want to do a daytime scene, everything's got to be bright and lively and a beautiful sunny day outside and there are people eating in the cafeteria. A cardiac surgeon might spend a lot of time in the OR and might finish in the middle of the night, so if she's coming here for a bite to eat, you might see the tables all shoved off to one side, the chairs upside down resting on the table, and the janitor with that waxing thing. I don't know why every time in the middle of the night you see that janitor with that waxing thing, but there he is. It's kind of a reality, I guess. But you can see them come to the commissary. You know it's some ungodly hour because everything is dark. The gift shop is closed. There's a minimal amount of lights on, and the guy is waxing. Yeah. This is unusual. We have a ceiling here because we have a second story, which is also unusual. I've seen this elaborate detail on sets for feature films, but not so much for television. Remember, up until recently, your set was this big. Now that it's bigger, we gotta concentrate on the detail. Take a look at the vending machine. What brands of soda do they sell?
Generic.
Not this? No, you don't see that brand right there?
No. Not Coke and Pepsi?
No.
Just found it over here.
No, they're just sitting there. So, can you hold it? Like, if there is a product placement deal with Coke, how would they hold it?
Right here.
Where's brand out.
Where am I looking?
Yeah.
Right here.
And if there is no product placement deal, yep.
No money.
I know. It looks a little. And they might even have a different can. Our sign shop sometimes can make it where there's no shiny element to it because that is very reflective. If we could see the cameraman in the Coke can, then we could get one that looks a little bit more traditional. The red, the fonts might be slightly bigger so it's more legible, and it would be flat so there is no reflection. So they will make that vending machine candy. If you're eating like a bag of Fritos, they also might have a special bag that has no shine to it, so it is flat, and maybe the lettering is slightly bigger. You also see that on
technology in an office or a home, you know, the logos might be slightly bigger. And that way it's legible and it photographs a little bit better. So there's all sorts of trick there. About 90% of the time, when you see a brand clearly, there is some sort of deal made. That means that they have either licensed that brand or they have done some sort of product placement arrangement. If somebody is saying, hey, you want a Coke? That's product integration. That's a whole other thing. If you see Pan Am Airlines in a flashback, somebody owns that. Somebody actually owns, even though the airline doesn't exist, somebody owns the branding. So that's why you could have like the counters and all the, you know, the uniforms on the stewardesses when they were stewardesses and all. Somebody owns that and they will license that. So it adds a little bit of authenticity. Yeah. There's always a little bit of a clash between the creative people and the people who want to make the deals. But keep in mind, a brand new show works in a deficit for the first 3 years. So those product placement deals help offset that. That's, you know, and once they start getting the syndication deal and the home video deal, then things reverse. Everyone getting the shots they want?
Mm-hmm.
One final thing. You notice the windows are not quite perfectly aligned. Can you see they're kind of off? Anybody know why?
Reflection.
Reflection, exactly. So if we are shooting, if I'm shooting right there, and you can see me in the glass, they just make that slight tilt. All right, I tell you what, any studio can build what you see here. What makes us unique is our backlot, so we're going to head out in that area. You got all the photos you want? Oh, they brought this back. This is my favorite part. The historical timeline.
You kids should be in school. School is very important. Oh, it is Saturday. So as I said again, you're doing it to your children.
I can answer your questions earlier.
That's how you get your street from inside. You see outside, that's how you get your blue sky and sunshine.
I thought you did it outside.
Yeah.
I guess weather conditions.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah, that makes it an illusion of outside. You said they can put, they can take a photograph.
I like this. It makes it seem like you're in a
site. That works. That's what you see in that
site.
Yep.
So you may hear one of us mention other productions from different companies that film here because
3D.
They might not have had space on their lot, and so they rented space from us. Superstore with America Ferrera shoots in Soundstage 22 and 23. So imagine the same square footage we just saw. Twice that is needed just for the floor of the Superstore. And then the operating theater and cardiac ward for Heartbeat is in 29. Another very elaborate set. Then over here, it's Soundstage 27, the Mindy Project. Now, Mindy does things a little differently. They have multiple sets in one giant soundstage. So you have her office, you have her apartment, you have what everyone refers to as the fantasy apartment, and then there's a lot of extra square footage. I would say the equivalent to the square footage that we were just in for what's called a swing set. So if you need to build a set that's only going to be seen in this week's episode, they can construct that there. If he goes to the post office, you need a post office, which may just be two walls forming a corner and a counter, because that's all the camera needs to see. They can build that there. We have a new half-hour sitcom called Crowded, and it stars Patrick Herbert and Stacey Keach this week. Betty White is guest starring, but why does she not? They shoot over here, and then in 43 and 44 right here, Eva LaGuardia's new show, Telenovela.
Hey.
guys know what a telenovela is, right? Spanish soap opera. She plays the hottest Spanish soap opera star in the world. And ironically, she does not speak Spanish. People find that very funny, but that is not that crazy, believe it or not. Oh, you're toasting Ted over there. I think the adults should know who Ted is. I'm not sure if the kids should know who Ted is. But there he is, having his morning mimosa. Betty Longoria also has directed some episodes, and she is one of the producers on the show. So a really wonderful opportunity to show off her comic talents. She was always very, very funny on Desperate Housewives, but the novella is affording her a chance to really show off how funny she was. She was part of an improv group in L.A. before Desperate Housewives, called Hot Tamales Live. So now she gets to have a lot more fun on the show. Take a look at these bungalows here on Gilbert's side. These are offices for writers, directors, producers, actors. Robert Zemeckis has a bungalow. Mark Platt, who brought the book Wicked to Broadway, he has a bungalow here. The De Laurentiis Company has a bungalow here, which used to be Alfred Hitchcock's old bungalow. Take a look. We still keep the profile right next to the front door. So I want you to ponder for a quick second. Hannibal Lecter was developed in the same bungalow where Norman Bates was developed decades early. Yeah, just think about that for a second. By the way, both Norman Bates and Hannibal Lecter took inspiration from a real guy named Ed Gein. Yeah, some of you who are interested in true crime stories, I can't imagine Ed Gein's story making it to the big screen, and definitely not the small screen. He was a lot worse than Hannibal and Norman Bates, yeah. But when you take a character from a book like Psycho, the book can get the audience to use a lot of imagination, fill in some of the blanks. When you're doing a movie, it might help to have some sort of prototype. Let's put it that way. And Ed Gein was definitely the prototype for most serial killers. This is the backlot. A lot of these buildings are what we call facades, false fronts. This view right here, take a look right there. That is what you see often on the Mindy Project as Greenwich Village. And so the show opens there. Now you have to imagine all the stuff that you need to create that New York look. We have taxi cabs lining the street. We have signage. New York has something we don't have, a change of season. So in October, when it still could be 105 degrees outside, they might be working on the Christmas episode. Imagine it's 105 and you're wearing a parka and snow boots. All right. Everything we've talked about so far really falls under the category of low technology. So we're going to shift gears right now, and we are going to go over and show off some high technology with the help of this guy.
Thank you.
Hawk 363, baby. You can take the glasses off for a little bit. But we don't leave the building. Give it a good once over there. Look, the movie screens are over 40 feet tall and 180 feet long. And we got two screens, one on each side. This attraction was built for the big trams that do the regular studio tour. Those big trams are the equivalent of four Winnebagos linked together. In fact, they're made by Winnebago. So all four cars fit there, and you see things great for both sides. We're a little smaller, a little bit more agile, so we can actually park right in the middle of the building, and you see both screens perfectly. I don't want to say too loud. Get a great view. Now, most of you are following King Kong from one side to the other. Whatever he's doing, you're following. Now, if you visit often, you might decide, let me see what's happening on the other screen while everyone else is looking at King Kong. There is stuff going on. I'm not going to tell you what, but there is stuff happening. So, get the same challenge. Instead of having one screen in front of you, two screens. Imagine a director trying to direct action on two simultaneous screens. But he was able to pull it off. Now, a movie like King Kong needs high technology and low technology. So, King Kong and the Empire State Building, high tech. King Kong, or actually all the humans on the streets of New York, can be low tech. We can build sets just like our metropolitan sets, but they have to be period specific. Wardrobe for the time period is very important. Not only is it another time period, it's winter in New York, so it's got to reflect that properly. You also need cars driving up and down the street. Now, anytime you see a car on camera, it's a picture car. Here are some stellar examples of picture cars. Magnum's Ferrari, take a look. That is a Genoa Desert Rail with a Volkswagen engine. A real Ferrari was used in close-ups with Tom Selleck at the wheel. This is what the stunt driver drove. We have this car, 46 Ford from Back to the Futures 1 and 2. That car never crashed into a manure truck. There was never an impact. You never saw a dented vehicle afterwards. There was a lot of quick edits, a really cool musical score, and some creative dialogue. Okay, not that creative dialogue, but we have some cars from the future. You know, the year 2015, last year? Yeah, last year is the future.
Isn't it?
Welcome to the present. And we got some cars from the Stone Age. These three cars from the Flintstones with John Goodman are golf carts. If you look closely, you have steering columns and turning axles. The close-up cars move through the courtesy of Fred's 2 feet. The Fast and the Furious cars, keep in mind, for each car you see, there could be up to 15 identical cars. Different cars are designed to do different things. They could be built for speed, or to jump, or to crash. Whatever the script requires us to do. So there's dozens of reasons why you should not try to do this at home. Not to mention, there's high technology involved, like green screens or blue screens. Speaking of which, look at the gyrosphere from Jurassic World. What's missing?
The glass.
Why isn't it there? Yes. And it broke, yeah. So you had that contraption, which is blue, and two actors seated, and they were shot in front of a green screen. Why a blue screen? Why not a blue screen? Because that thing is blue. So you shoot in front of a green screen. By the way, we could also use orange, purple, gray, whatever color we program the camera not to recognize. But blue and green are the more common. Also means that the wardrobe choices have to be very carefully selected. Because those boys were wearing the same thing throughout most of the movie. So if they're going to be doing stuff in front of a green screen or a blue screen, you need to make sure that the colors are properly situated. Imagine the first Spider-Man movie when Spider-Man is fighting the Green Goblin. Spider-Man wears a lot of blue in his costume and the Green Goblin wears a lot of green. But they needed to use both. We try to save as much as we can from the Jurassic Park movies. Most of the stuff you're looking at is from the first three. Fleetwood RV was pushed over a cliff in the second movie. The clip is actually a parking structure right across the street from the sound stage we were visiting earlier. There's a few disgruntled dinosaurs on the lot, and... There's a section of the Jeep there, just what the camera needed. It's not unusual to chop off the front end or the back end of a vehicle, so you can shoot over the shoulder of the actors, or you can get the camera right up on the windshield there for close-ups. Or you might need to cut off the back end so we can shoot the people in the back seat, how they react. I've also seen it slice the other way. Now we're heading over to Old Mexico. This part of Old Mexico you've seen Flint Flips, Rio Vigos, and Gideon West. Desperate Housewives of Monterey. Yeah. I didn't see this section in episodes of Hale's Navy when they were killing themselves. It's just a great utilitarian set. But today, we are going to stage a storm. Storm requires three different types of ingredients. Now, thunder is a sound effect. Lightning is a carbon arc lighting effect. Rain is created by pointing sprinklers upward. That is the trick. The water shoots up into the air and then drops naturally. So gravity is key. There we go. How long can we let it rain? Forever? No, we can't let it rain forever. We're going to have a flooding problem. There's no absorption in the ground. You know, we've had this drought and a heat wave. The ground is like hard, like concrete now. So they said we could let it rain for a little bit, and then we have to stop and let everything dry out. Uh-oh. All right, our flash flood. That's actually the oldest animation one can have our tracks on the media source. It's from all the way back to 1968, the first one we brought in here. Oh yeah, it's all recycled. It all gets sent back to the top of the hill. Listen to this scene. Paul Giamatti is screaming into a microphone, watching footage of his stunt double do the fall. So he's only in half the scene. The other two actors, Frankie Muniz and Amanda Bynes, also have to come back and re-record their dialogue. Everything you heard in that scene was re-recorded, then added in later. Coincidentally, this area of the lot predates sound. It's called Six Points, Texas. Each individual street could be dressed to be a separate town, and you could do six different movies at the same time because sound was not going to be an issue. We used to do about 200 questions a year. So this is the most filmed area in the world, and it still gets used. The road on my side, that was Australia. In the early 20th century, for saving Mr. Banks, Colin Farrell was almost fired. Well, his character was, yeah. The voice did a promo here. You have Blake Shelton and Adam Levine having a standoff in the middle of the street. There is a movie called Lit by Night, directed by Ben Affleck, and he's also starring, and it's set during Prohibition time, so they use the Western sets and some of our metropolitan sets for that. And if you remember the Blues Brothers, the good old boys, Winnebago, went right down here into the lake. Charles Napier was the leader of the band, driver of Winnebago. Sometimes the cowboys big stars that we had, Audie Murphy, Alan Ladd. You know, they were not even Michael J. Fox type.
Hey, hey.
How do you compensate for that? What? Heels? I would say lifts, maybe not heels. They can stand on a box. Also, we make the doorway shorter. John Wayne, Jimmy Stewart, they were above average height. So, oftentimes they would be in the street. Because they would tower over anybody else on set. So they would have to be arranged differently, so you would be concentrating on what they're saying to each other, not the difference in height. In front of us is soundstage 50. It houses the only two-level or double-decker set in Hollywood, one set built directly on top of another set. Now, we saw that on the Heartbeat set. Yeah, it is possible now for the cameras to go right upstairs and follow the actor. The cameras are lighter, they're a little bit more agile, so it is possibility that we have. This has been around for several years, predating shows like Heartbeat. So at one time, this was the only double-decker or two-level set. And as soon as we can open the front door, we'll go inside. There is a production. It looks like there's people working out here today, but I don't think they're shooting anything. It's a show called Home and Family. It airs on the Hallmark Channel Monday through Friday. And every day they have cooking segments, backyard entertaining segments, home improvement, celebrity interviews. They shoot on one day and then it airs the following morning. So they shoot the segments throughout the day. So if you're doing a cooking segment, you drop the casserole dish, guess what? You can redo it. If your guest star is stuck in traffic, it's okay. You'll run around. But it's Hallmark, so they like to exploit every holiday that Hallmark makes part. Which is every holiday. Now you can see the inside. Look at the details. You heard ear maps, ticket selling machines. We were talking about product placement before. And it does add a hint of realism. You saw a billboard for Acme Credit Card. Stay calm, stay seated. Television series called Bones. Anybody watch the show Bones? Great show, David Boreanaz, Emily Deschanel. Check out this scene right here, you might recognize it. From an episode called Bones and the Blue Line.
What's going on? Kind of like deja vu, right?
Just
experience that. That's what it looks like on television. But we're going to calm things down with a nice little trip to the beach. We're heading to Amity Island, which I know some of you may have heard of before. Yes, we have had some shark problems in the past, but not in the present. We don't have it. We got that cart shark hanging up right there on the right. It's not going to bother anybody ever again. Seeing to that is an officer of the Amity Police Department. That's his boat out there. That belongs to Officer George. There, he's coming up for some air. He's got company out there in the water. It's circling right for him. 1 second, please.
George! George, get out of the water! There's a shark heading right for you! Swim for the boat!
Oh. Well, he had a lot of guts to be out there, ladies and gentlemen. And there they are. Okay, wow. All right. We should be fine as long as you stay out of the water. You know, people go on the trolley goes in the water, sharks in the water, so... We're gonna play it safe right here behind these flammable gas tanks. Should be fine right here, folks. I have a theory. And maybe we can test the theory. I'm seeing a chain reaction form here. We got gasoline spraying everywhere. Maybe, just need it there. There we go. Yeah, the sharks don't like fire. Fire doesn't mix well with water. Sharks live in water, so it kind of makes sense in a weird way. All right, buddy. Give it up for Bruce, the mechanical shark from the hit film Jaws. Did a great job today. Did not do such a great job on the set of Jaws. The very first time they tried to use the mechanical shark making the movie, it sank to the bottom of the ocean. Here's what happened. They tested the shark originally on our front lot inside of Soundstage 27 where they filmed for the Mindy Project. There's an underwater pit inside that stage. So they utilized that. They tested out the sharks. They said, great, it works. That was freshwater. When they decided to switch to on-location filming off the coast of Martha's Vineyard, they didn't have time to test them in salt water before they started filming. They had to find out the hard way. Salt water messed with the mechanics, gummed up the works, caused a big delay in the production, pushing it over 100 days past its schedule because they couldn't quite get the shots they needed. Mechanical sharks just didn't work out too well, causing the crew members to jokingly refer to the production as flaws. They coped through humor. Now, when I was growing up, I always thought the shark's name was Jaws, but it turns out it's Bruce. He's named after Steven Spielberg's attorney, Bruce Raymer. Still, his attorney to this day took the joke very well. It was referenced in the movie Finding Nemo. The name of the great white shark in that movie is Bruce, in honor of our Bruce. A little homage right there. Now, we're going to pass by some suburban areas of our lot and head up the hill. Here on the right, you'll see our chicken ranch set. That was the best little whorehouse in Texas with Dolly Parton and Burt Reynolds. It's also seen in San Francisco for our NBC comedy series About a Boy with David Walton and Minnie Driver. You'll see the neighbor's house. The yellow house doesn't get much to it. Again, we only build the camera sees. That's it. That is all. And, that's not supposed to be there. That's a really nice car there on the left. Dodge Charger, I think. But no license plate, no drive on pass. My hands are tied. I gotta call security, let them know about this. Security, are you aware of the situation we have with the
studio tour? Looks like we might have an issue. I'm patching in to Agent Novak from the FBI.
I'm sorry to interrupt your fun, but we've got video surveillance on that charger you all saw. We ran it through the system, and the driver has been positively identified as Dominic Toretto. I've been tracking this guy for a while. He's a hardened criminal. He's likely armed, and he's definitely dangerous. Ben and I are on our way to apprehend him right now. If you see him, don't be a hero. Don't engage him. Just keep a safe distance and report any further sightings to studio security immediately. We'll handle it from there.
All right, you got it. We'll keep our eyes peeled. Until then, the show must go on, right? That's what they say in the biz. We're just going to continue moving on. Actually, we're going to pass by an area known for visual effects here on the right called Falls Lake. Take a look over your right shoulder, just past the trees. You see a big blue backdrop back. Oh, he's back already.
Look, this might be more serious than I thought. What just happened? This is a secure line. Who are you?
I'll tell you who I am, boy. I'm the reason bad guys use a nightlight. I'm the reason the boogeyman begs his mama to look under his bed. And I'm the reason you just lost control of this whole operation. My name is Special Agent Luke Hobbs of the U.S. Diplomatic Security Service. And as of 16.9 seconds ago, I'm the man in charge.
The hell you are!
Let me clue you in on two things, sweet cheeks. One, There's a high-value witness from the Federal Protection Program aboard your vehicle.
Really?
And two, an international crime syndicate led by Owen Shaw is honing in on this vehicle to take that witness out. Shaw's as ruthless as they come, and he'll stop at nothing to eliminate his target. Every living soul on this vehicle is in serious danger. Other than that, enjoy the ride.
This is not your jurisdiction.
It is now, stink pickle.
I'm so tired of you stink guys stepping in. Just whenever you feel like...
Mute him.
Okay.
Don't you...
That's better. We're moving your vehicle to a safe location until we have the situation under control. Until then, I want everybody to stay calm. Enjoy the ride. I'm taking care of business. Hobbs out.
Well, this is an interesting situation we just found ourselves in. We're going to keep everyone safe, not just the witness, maybe like especially the witness, but everyone. Safety all around. Look under your seats. You get safety. You get safety. You all get safety today. We'll move into our safe location in just a moment. I think they're just getting ready for us here. The Sullivan Truck Repair. Inconspicuous looking location. But since this might conceivably be the last time giving the tour, I should point out that big blue backdrop I was talking about a moment ago that makes up our area known as Falls Lake. That big blue backdrop was originally created for Jaws the Revenge, but we have a number of different options there. We can build set pieces on top of it, like for the Jurassic Park movies. We can paint backdrops on top, anything we want. We got a big concrete pit that we can fill up with dirt, water, sand, anything. It's used in the Truman Show with Jim Carrey. That's the end of Truman Burbank's world. It's where the mermaids attack the pirates and Pirates of the Caribbean on Stranger Tides with Johnny Depp and Keira Knightley. That got a gasp. You got a fan. Excellent. It's also where Jim Carrey walked on water in Bruce Almighty, Morgan Freeman. There's the use of the blue screen and the green screen effect right there. Boom. It's also where the van falls for what seems like the entire movie of Inception. With Leonardo DiCaprio, it's the first level of the dream that's falling off the bridge, lands in our Falls Lake area. It's like the ticking time bomb of the movie. Need the password, or is it open sesame? Awesome. Here we go. I got the touch. Awesome. We're going to head inside. Guy's going to get out of the open so the Shaw character doesn't find us. We're going to head inside, scope it out. Hopefully, got someone in here telling us what we're going to be doing next. Oh, well, at the very least, the vehicles get much nicer once we head inside. It's a really cool truck right there. I like the paint job on the front of it. It's got some bite. It's got some edge. We also have an assault vehicle up a little further with a high-caliber turret on the back. That could prove useful. Better to have it, not need it, than need it, not have it. Hey, there's somebody down. Hello, sir. Can you help us? We just got in here.
Name is Roman Pierce.
Hello.
Pleased to meet you.
Likewise.
My buddy Hobbs asked us to stash you Shaw for a while. So we brought you in our secret spot.
All right, look, guys, we're going to keep Shaw from finding you, but to keep you safe, we need your help. We don't want the syndicate tracking us here, so put away your cameras and turn off your cell phones. One flash or one ringtone could give us away.
I need y'all to take this real serious.
Okay, pull into the next bay and we'll meet you in there.
All right, you got it. See, so they got our backs. I mean, they seem to have a good handle on things. Hopefully everyone's feeling better. I'm feeling a little bit better about our situation right now. I think we got everything covered, so... You heard him, no cell phones for the time being, no calling, texting, tweeting, Instagramming, Snapchatting, whatever your kids are doing these days. I don't know what the new hot app is. Just not right now. Maybe later, after we survive this life or death situation. I think the key, guys, is just to blend in with our surroundings. As soon as we stick out, that's when Shaw's going to find us. So whatever they throw at us, whatever we've got coming our way, just blend in. Feel the vibe of the room, go with the flow. Go with the flow. Oh, this is my speed. This is this person. I love this. This is good. I approve.
I don't work for you.
Oh, really? Well, tell me, Roland, who do you work for? we don't work for nobody. Cop, I suggest you clear out of here, otherwise we can't guarantee your safety.
Guarantee my safety? I'm the one holding the gun.
Yeah, but mine's a whole lot bigger than yours. Hobbs, escort this novice out.
Let's go, Cookie Puss!
Got an ugly suit on, man. It's cheap.
Somebody out there really pissed off Shaw. It's gonna get ugly fast.
Yeah, don't worry. Lucky for you, our whole family will protect you.
Are you kidding me, Roman? You didn't shut off your phone, bro?
I gotta call you back. I'm in another second.
See what I'm talking about?
Call you back.
Aaron.
It was on vibrate. Shaw traced us. Ops can't hold him forever. Letty, Roman, we're up. Try to move that vehicle. It's about to get real interesting. My Mona Lisa's all warmed up right next door.
Roman, grab your truck. I need you and Letty ready to roll.
Well, hate to say it, guys. Looks like they tracked us down after all. So just get ready to hold on tight in case we need to make a run for it. And thinking out loud, you might want to toss on those 3D glasses. Yeah, we're going to treat them like protective eyewear this time around. I think they're very durable, and possibly even bulletproof. Which could prove handy, because I'm hearing some crazy stuff in this parking garage. Can you duck inside it now? Yeah, there it is. That's that sound. Oh. Glasses on, fingers crossed. Hopefully we can get out of this one.
Which one of you is the witness? Speak now or you all get fried!
This is our turn.
No! After them!
Okay, guys, it's your turn! Come, cover them up! This thing ain't moving fast enough! Roger, ready, hook him up!
You guys enjoyed that? Awesome. I'm looking forward to the next installment, Fast and Furious 8, coming out next year. They officially confirmed one of the villains is being played by the lovely Charlize Theron. Oh, yes. I think they cast her because she had a character in Mad Max Fury Road named Furiosa. So now it's Fast and Furiosa. Yes, Scott Eastwood is also confirmed for the cast. I love it. Looking forward to Fast and Furious 8, 9, and 10. They're all on their way. We're hitting double digits. Because you keep seeing them, we keep making them. That's how it goes.
Hi.
It might be Fast and Furious X. Fast X. Furious X. Yeah, thank you. So guys, we're going to double back a little bit. We're going to show you some really amazing sets here that are kind of hard to reuse. These are very specific, very particular sets we're going to be passing through here. Like this one right here, Whoville from Dr. Seuss's How the Grinch Stole Christmas. Now, it took a lot to bring Whoville to life. It took 2 million linear feet of styrofoam to build all the sets of Whoville, enough artificial snow to cover 9 football fields, 1,938 candy canes were used in the movie, and the Whomobiles you see here on the set, they are actually drivable. They're modified golf carts with fiberglass designs that fit right on top. I would love to take one for a spin. It'd be like Wacky Races. You remember that old cartoon? It'd be fun. They organize a little race around the back lot. Or for more the more modern generations, it'd be like live-action Mario Kart. It'd be sweet. No tortoise shells or banana peels, just a fun race. Now, I gotta say this for the Whos, okay? I love them. They're very fun, very jovial, very festive people. They certainly embody the holiday spirit, but they have some pretty crazy neighbors. First off, they have to live next door to the Grinch, who kind of puts a damper on their holiday plans every year. But they also have to live next door to some pretty crazy people on our back lot. You see, they kind of drew the short end of the stick on the real estate here on the property. I think that's why they got such a great deal. They have to live right next door to Norman Bates and his dear sweet old mother from the Alfred Hitchcock classic, Psycho. There it is, the Bates Motel and the Psycho House. Now, we kind of got an early start to our day. Does anyone want to grab a shower while we're here? Is anyone, like, in a rush this morning? Or no? No takers? I just like to be polite and offer. I think you've made the wise call here. The Yelp reviews on this place, that's the real horror show.
Zoom in, man. Zoom in.
I'm surprised there are Yelp reviews. People actually make it out of this place and decide to write a warning review.
Thanks, buddy.
They got clean sheets.
Now the Psycho House you're seeing up the staircase there, that was actually built at a slightly smaller scale to make Anthony Perkins seem much more menacing by contrast, again creating a slight forced perspective. It was built on a 7/8 scale. So we're going to head up from the motel here up the Psycho Path to the Psycho House. And as we pass by the Psycho House, you might want to say hi to Mother. She wonders why you don't call. She actually is in the second floor window in the front of the house there. Very front of the house, second floor window. If you want to just give her a little wave. She's holding up very well, I gotta say, for her age. She's looking very good. Hi, Ma. There she is. She likes this better than being stuck down in the fruit cellar. She does not like it down there. Now, guys, we got another VIP excursion lined up for you now. We're about to take you through one of the most elaborate sets in film history, the crash site from Steven Spielberg's 2005 version of War of the Worlds, starring Tom Cruise and Dakota Fanning. A couple of quick rules in place for your safety on this particular VIP excursion, guys. The roadway we just came in on is now here on the right-hand side. We're gonna stay out of that roadway at all times. That's where the regular tram traffic is coming through. Instead, we've laid out this nice path here on the left. You can follow me through. We'll make sure you stay nice and safe on that pathway. There's a lot of sharp debris in the area. Please stay on the path. Bring your cameras. Leave your bags if you like. If you want to leave your 3D glasses right there on that sideways seat, we'll collect those from you there. Follow us right this way.
Seen the movie, or if it's been a while, let me set the stage for you here, okay? Tom Cruise and his children, played by Dakota Fanning and Justin Chatwin, they're hiding out from an alien invasion. They narrowly escape. They manage to get away in one of the few working cars left. They go down to his ex-wife's house because it's his weekend with the kids with the aliens. So they go down to his ex-wife's house. The neighborhood is still intact. Everything's calm, peaceful. It's just everyone's been evacuated at that point. but the house is still intact. So they go in the house. They decide to hide down in the basement for the night, thinking that's going to be the safest place for them. You see the boarded up basement door just up the way here. Now, we're in the basement with them the entire time they are, following the action of the characters. They get awoken in the middle of the night by strange noises, strange lights coming through the window, loud rumbling noises. In the morning, when things seem to have calmed down, Tom Cruise comes up from the basement to inspect what's happened. And here's the genius of a master filmmaker like Steven Spielberg, a great storyteller. Keeps the camera shot very tightly framed just on the living room area. Things still look fairly normal for the most part, but you see a look of shock come across Tom Cruise's face. As he moves closer to what he's looking at, the camera pulls back to reveal what it is. A jet engine in the living room still spinning on fire. As Tom Cruise moves closer to the camera, it dollies back, and you start to see there's actually not much of the house left at all. Pans over to show you that the plane has crashed through the neighborhood, and that's what caused all the ruckus in the night, and they're so very lucky to have survived it. Very careful, very deliberate revealing of things. Very carefully done. Now, I know what some of you might be asking yourselves, so I'm going to answer it right now. The answer is yes, this is a real 747 aircraft. This plane flew at one point. For many years and many miles, after that amount of time, that many miles, the planes do have to be retired and get put into what are called airplane graveyards. This one was found in the Mojave Desert by the production team for War of the Worlds. Purchased for around $60,000. Not bad, kids save up now. It was cost nearly $200,000 more just to get it shipped here to the Universal backlot. That's just shipping and handling costs. $200,000, roughly. So, $60,000 plane, $200,000 to get it here, only in the movie for one scene, lasting less than 5 minutes of total screen time. And I say it's worth every penny, wouldn't you agree, now that we're here? Let's get a little bit of a closer look as we head down the way here.
That is awesome.
Wave to your fans, you can hide your face and say no photos. If you want to pretend like we just crawled out of this wreckage, go for it. Now, if you can tell how old this plane is, guys, if you look carefully at the armrests, they have ashtrays. Now, something to keep in mind while you're admiring this set, guys, is how quickly the movie War of the Worlds is put together. Movie this time. This magnitude. From the very first day of pre-production to when it was released in theater for a worldwide audience, around 9 months. That's how quickly it all came together. Steven Spielberg had assembled a crew of people he's worked with on various productions in the past. Things were streamlined, things gelled together very nicely. And he reassured his producer partner, Kathleen Kennedy, when he went through the script, told her how quickly he wants to move on the project. He said, "I don't want you to panic. We're only focusing on three characters, Tom Cruise and his kids. Else kind of happens in the background. Case in point, you never see this plane actually crash. You only see the aftermath. If you do a good enough job setting up the tone and atmosphere of the production, give you guys enough of a blank slate to fill in with your imagination, it can really impact you. You're filling it in, you know what scares you, you can kind of prey on your fears like that. Thanks for meeting us halfway. Really appreciate it. The audience participation is awesome."
Woo!
Now, every so often, some guests will ask us, why is this set still here? It's a valid question. Usually when the sets like these are set up, you usually strike them to free the space up for another production to move in. But I told you how much it costs just to get the plane here. So they gave us a call and said, would you like to do attraction for your tour? We said, absolutely. Worked out a great deal. The only thing that was part of the deal is that no production was allowed to film on this set for 5 years. It was only meant to be known as the War of the Worlds set. And once that 5 years had elapsed in 2010, productions did start taking advantage of this new site to film on. They've had commercials filmed here for Duracell batteries, Pepsi mini cans with Cuba Gooding Jr., really fun commercial. Also, life insurance commercials, can't imagine why. Episodes of Community with Joel McHale filmed here, really fun sketch from Key and Peele, music videos with Rihanna and Nicki Minaj. And you guys like Halloween?
Yes.
We do something really cool every year, an annual special event called Halloween Horror Nights. Unique to Universal Studios Hollywood is an experience called the Terror Tram. We take the regular tour vehicles, turn it into a shuttle of sorts. We shuttle you guys down from the theme park to the Whoville set, where you disembark, walk through Whoville, past the Bates Motel, the Psycho House, and through this crash site all at night while guys dressed up in various costumes jump out at you. Past couple of years, it's been themed after some really fun properties like Scream 4, The Purge, and The Walking Dead. Awesome. It really is a fun time. Come back and visit us if you can. Now, the fun thing about this VIP excursion, guys, is this is kind of a twofer. So be very careful. Watch your step. We're going to be heading back this way. Right back here, guys, you're going to see a set from another Steven Spielberg film. This is Site B from the Lost Worlds Jurassic Park. This is where they get chased into Site B by some very angry, very clever velociraptors. You can actually almost see the shot of Jeff Goldblum and Julianne Moore running up the stairs here, trying to get to the helicopter, landing on that big helipad by that tree right over there. It was also recycled in Jurassic Park 3, directed by Joe Johnston. And as you can see, it's kind of fallen into a state of disrepair. That is naturally occurring. We do get some earthquakes here from time to time, some inclement weather. And as we've kind of been stressing, it's not exactly the same materials that it appears to be. Not really made to last, just made to look good to the camera. That is a real house up there. If you want to give away, maybe they're having their morning coffee. This is their backyard view. So when they were setting up for War of the Worlds, they were, the neighbors here that have a nice backyard view of this site were actually compensated by the production, saying, hey, here's a free cruise, enjoy, while they set up everything. That way no photos leaked out online, anything like that. This became their backyard view when they came back.
See? Now we got a lot.
Yes.
Tail section of the plane here is a little bit dirtier than the rest of the plane. That is by design. It's covering up the call numbers, the serial numbers of the plane. You get air traffic flying overhead. We don't want to cause panic. I think this thing here long enough that enough pilots know when they're flying over certain coordinates that it's actually a movie studio. But it was cause for concern when they first started filming here for War of the Worlds. They covered up those call numbers. Never want to cause panic like the original radio drama that Orson Welles put on. You guys remember hearing about that?
Yeah.
Did a radio drama version of War of the Worlds, and people thought it was an actual radio broadcast. The news was telling people about Martians invading, so people took to the street with shotguns, were calling up the police, wondering where to go, what to do. Orson Welles was told mid-broadcast what was going on. He just said, we'll apologize for it tomorrow. We'll tell him tomorrow. But any questions, guys? Stunned silence, I can work with that. If you guys need any help with photos, again, more than happy to help you out with group photos. We're getting pretty good at the photography thing. Grab some last photos, guys, otherwise we're gonna hop back on our vehicle. We've got so much more we wanna show you.
So here's what this amazing crash site set looked like in War of the Worlds.
Is a perfect example of a set that is all designed about the vision of Stephen
Cohen. For them to sit down and talk about the world, that thought, what if the 747 goes down right in a big neighborhood? Because it's just something you don't see.
You're doing good. If you think that it does me, as a man, it's all too good. I'm close to it. Get in.
See, he wouldn't have had to tell me twice. I would have just gotten in the car. I would have been very freaked out and would have wanted to have left. Like they're leaving right now. Absolutely amazing. Just under 5 minutes seeing all that hard work, all that preparation, all that setup. Beautiful, beautiful thing. Now, as we head down the hill here, guys, you are going to see an entranceway for a street here on the right. That is Wisteria Lane from Desperate Housewives, also known as Colonial Street. They have had a lot of big productions filming there lately, some great commercial work, and also an upcoming feature film that I'm really looking forward to because I love the cast. Bryan Cranston and James Franco are doing a comedy together. It's called Why Him? Be on the lookout for that. You'll see those sets up. Yeah. Over here on the right as well, you'll see a little bit of Elm Street. That's where they filmed the classic To Kill a Mockingbird with Gregory Peck and Robert Duvall. In fact, you can see Boo Radley's house there on the end, the yellow house with the green roof. That was Boo Radley's. By the way, if you thought our Jaws attraction looked a little familiar, it might be because you really like the really fun little show starring Angela Lansbury called Murder, She Wrote. That's Cabin Cove, Maine, right there. Now, we are approaching some really fun stops on our VIP tour, but I think we got the most popular stop coming up next, which is a restroom stop. All right, so we're going to be actually taking over to some secret restrooms over here on the right onto our Denver Street. So if anyone needs a restroom, more than happy to point it out to you guys. If you need a VIP, here we go. Sorry, I love that joke too much. I can't bear to part with it. As cheesy as it is. All right, if anyone needs a restroom, I'm more than happy to point it out to you. It's just down the way. You guys, we got any fans of Back to the Future here?
Oh yeah.
That's two hands. Wow. Super fan. Excellent.
Marty!
Marty! There's one fun clip I always like to show if I ever have a moment to do so. I like candid moments on set. Sometimes what sneaks onto blooper reels are pranks that are played on the set. There's one prank that was played on Michael J. Fox during a scene where his character, Marty, is supposed to be drinking from a flask of liquor. Of course, when you're doing that scene, you can't actually have it be filled with the real hard stuff, because by take 10, take 20, take 30, you start slurring your speech, forgetting your lines, getting a little tipsy. So it's usually just tap water, except for one take, where the crew played a joke on him and filled it up with the real hard stuff. Let's watch his reaction.
Anybody drank.
Hands up if you're not here. Awesome. You passed the test. And we're not leaving anybody behind, because that'd be really embarrassing and a lot of paperwork. Alright guys, so here we go. We're getting ready for a really amazing VIP excursion coming up next. You're actually going to start seeing on the other side of our Six Points, Texas area, these little benches, pieces of wood here, got farming equipment, wagons, coffins, you name it. Those all qualify as props, short for property. Anything that is used to further enhance or decorate a set, anything that an actor can interact with, so it can be as small as a paperclip, as big as a grand piano, all qualifies as a prop. And we here at Universal Studios have the largest prop collection in Hollywood, around 2.5 million props and counting. Can't even fit it all in the big building we're about to visit, which is our property warehouse. That's why we have props scattered a little bit closer to the set that they're more likely to be used for. But here we go. We're getting ready to head to that big building that's now directly in front of us, our property warehouse. 3 floors of props. The top floor is where we have our costume department, which unfortunately has been off limits for some time now. We've been working on some highly sensitive material there. I don't know if I can name the production, let's just say I think they had like a couple of shades. But Tony's going to be kind enough to show us around our property department here today. Again, bring your cameras. You can take as many photos and videos as you like while we're inside, guys. Again, we just ask, please no touching while we're inside. It's one of those you break it, you bought it things. Especially true in here. You don't want to know the cost of some of these items. They get pricey. They really, really do.
Detailed information will be available on our computer system. And then when you come, you have to return the item that you rented from us in the same condition that you rented it. So, no upgrading, altering, improving on. You have to pay for it, yes. So even if you think that you are doing a good thing, no. That ugly sofa with the springs popping out and the duct tape is something that is very popular for us to rent. It's in every crack house, trailer park, back. It's hygienic for the actors. You know, you're not going to have a problem with bed bugs or whatever other problem you could have. Yeah, because it just looks horrible for the camera, but it's well maintained. You get one of those and you pretty it up, well then we can't use it. Yeah. So you always return the item to the condition that you found it. There's bits of interesting examples. They did rent a sofa to the Muppets recently and they did not return it in the condition it was found. They have to pay for the restoration. And it was part of a set. So even the pieces that they didn't rent that are part of the set are going to have to be reupholstered because they can't match the fabric perfectly. Yeah. They basically took a sofa and cut 3 holes in the cushions to cut it in. And they were specifically told they could not do anything. Have to be conscientious and stuff like that. But this is a profit center for Universal. And basically, they have to show... Most of our creative endeavors, imagine, you're making a movie or a TV show, and then you hope to make more money than it costs to make down the line, right? This is kind of more, you know, this place, its budget is depending on how much they rent. We have our own version of city bikes. You guys have, you're familiar with them, right? I've seen them in New York here, San Francisco, Chicago. They have it too? I saw it in Orlando as well. That's our version. We don't have, like, they're not locked up. But historically, bikes have been a great way to travel on the lot, even though we do have mills. Parking is a problem, and noise is a problem. I should break it. Most of the crew guys love the old shred beach bikes. 1965 Schwinn beach bikes are highly popular. Our metal shop guys are they weigh a ton when they're soft. And they have big baskets, and when you turn the handlebars, the basket stays we are encouraging people to get before. You know, even the ballpark sometimes are a little awkward. Yeah, you can't park them everywhere.
The registration number in the middle of the
bike can go anywhere. So you've got a park for a while for people in a basket and get a bike.
Yes.
Coming out. give you guys. Let's take a few more steps here. Check my money. That's just real quick. There's no one spot for stakers.
It's a big one.
Everything is
here. Back to all the school telephone system. You know, before there was any sort of dialing mechanism whatsoever, you picked up the receiver on your phone, a little light on that switchboard would come on. The operator would have to plug in what's called a patch cord, and they say, operator, who do you want to speak to? And you go, this is Mr. Smith, I need to talk to Mr. Jones. And then they would physically connect you to Mr. Jones, and the little lights would be on. That meant the conversation was in progress. That also means the operator could eavesdrop on the conversation, just saying, not judging, just saying that that's how it worked. And then when the lights go off, they could disconnect the patch cords. Very old school. This is not digital technology. It's not analog technology. It is whatever predates analog. This is pretty much basic electric circuitry. Yeah, pretty close to Alexander Graham Bell. That was built for the movie Changeling with Angelina Jolie. And then it was used in Gangster Squad and Public Enemy and Agent Carter and Pretty Little Liars. And right now it's in an AT&T commercial. So we built it for one movie, and we've been able to rent it to dozens of different projects over the years. Now, each little vignette that you see here, like we have the middle class 1960s American living room. A lot of the tour guides like to call it the Mad Men set, because that's what they mostly think of. Then you can go a little bit more upper class, right? Right, you have Asian themed, and then you have offices. So the vignettes that you see here were put together by Barbara Castle, who's the set decorator for the show Scandal. We discovered recently that some of the younger decorators needed a little help with some of the period specific props. If you weren't around when you would dial a phone, you know, you might not know exactly from when to when that would work. So we thought it'd be helpful, instead of just having racks of stuff, that if they kind of arrange it the way things should complement each other, it would be helpful for the decorators. It turned out to be very profitable too, because now they come in and go, yeah, I want all this stuff. So that was kind of an added bonus. But Barbara Castle is the set decorator for Scandal. The set decorator's job is to come here and pick the items that they're going to put on the set. So they don't design the set or build the set, they put stuff on the set. You can see, look at the office. That office furniture was rented out to the People versus O.J. Simpsons. A lot of this stuff was used in Robert Shapiro's office. If you look at the desk especially, you can create different time periods just by updating the phone. How much is it to rent? 15% of the insured value per week.
Oh my.
Yeah. Or TV show, week two, it'll drop. Week three, it'll drop a little bit more. Week four, it'll drop. When you go into week five, you're back to the original price.
Well, what point do they need to buy their own stuff?
They will need to buy some stuff. You know, you're going to do a location in San Francisco, you realize, oh, we need a sofa. You're going to send somebody over to Sears. Yeah. At the end of the production day, whatever was bought for that Universal production, those items become part of our collection. Yeah. And then every 3-4 months we have to kind of spin the collection out a little bit, so we have to
kind of right. What is that? That's Phoenix. That's the brand name. I'll take his word for it. Hi guys, how are you guys? Your kids should be in school.
It's still Saturday.
It is still Saturday. Why is it still Saturday? Hey, does any guys play the piano? If you're an actor playing a piano in a movie TV show set, you're probably not playing the piano. They put pillows in behind you so the music comes out. The music is always played in those pillows because they don't want your music on set.
It's too loud. So, Hand of God could actually be the name of the project. Hand of God could be a working title, meaning they haven't decided what they're actually going to call it, but they've got to call it something for now. Or it could be a little bit, we still call it a working title, but it's a misdirection. It could be something that is very specific, but they don't want anybody to know what the project is. It's a little distraction. For example, when Captain America the First Avenger was shooting, all the tags said Frostbite. For Winter Soldier, all the tags said Freezer Burn. But now we've got another problem. You look at that, you take out your smartphone, you look up that working title, they'll tell you what it really is. Yeah. Yeah, so that is now...
Yeah, man, just big foot.
If there's something that needs to be kept secret, we need to say it. A lot of the antique desks here, by the way, originally came from various offices. We had a long-standing rule that no executive could have modern furniture. They all had to have antiques. Then, of course, one executive would leave, a new one comes in. The new guy's not going to have the other guy's antiques. They got to get different antiques. So little by little, these antiques found their way into the prop department. Yes, we wrap around up. We do have a throne. It's Charlize Theron's throne from Snow White and the Huntsman. We have an Iron Maiden from The Man Who Laughs, an early Universal art film, 1928. This, we got Tina Fey did a commercial. And the Iron Maiden was used for The Man Who Laughs, and later on it's been in every other art film Universal ever made. Man Who Laughed, interesting research because the makeup and the story of the title character was a great inspiration for the Joker in the comic book several years later. Yeah, Marilyn we got from a charity event we did. The shark was used to promote the ride that we used to have in Orlando. E.T.'s on a throne from Gladiator. King Kong and the Lorax were used to promote those movies as lobby displays. And a couple of Egyptian pieces were used at night at the museum. And a couple of other pieces were used in The Mummy and The Mummy Returns and National Treasure. There's one sarcophagus that came from a theme park ride. It was called Castle Dracula featuring the Incredible Hulk. It was a very short-lived theme park attraction. It wasn't a ride, it was a show. Yeah, that he's from National, yeah. He gets like a special scene in National Treasure. Yeah, he's back in place there. He was away for a while. By the way, a lot of the Egyptian pieces, you might see in one project where they have this coloring, and then another project, they're solid gold, and in another project, they're a little bit more like earth tone, just like the Terracotta Warriors, that, you know, you could kind of get that color too. So you may have seen these over and over and over again. The big crucifix right on the end here, the skin tones will change from project to project. The amount of blood will change. Right now there's very little, but I've seen him when he's completely drenched in blood. And the color of the blood, I've seen like candy apple and fire engine red, I've seen burgundy and merlot and Zinfandel. Maybe not Zinfandel. I just wanted to make sure it was rosé. So each time that goes out, the art director might take on a different look. I mean, just to be very practically speaking, Jesus tends to match up with the demographic of the denomination. So if it's a little bit more Irish Catholic, he might be a little more fair. If it is a little bit more Hispanic, he might be a little bit more tan. But I've seen him fair-skinned, tan, and exsanguinated. The only time in the tour you can use the word exsanguinated. So you probably have seen that crucifix 100 different times, seriously, and not realizing that you're looking at the same thing over and over and over again. If you want, let's go catch up to Gilbert. Otherwise, Owen can help you get some shots. Not everything should be a selfie today.
We need that.
Doc, I mentioned a couple of things that you have to return the items on the day that you found them. There was a show called Rizzoli and Isles. They rented a big trunk. It's about three times the size of our ice chest here. But it was an older piece, and the lid actually folded over and then folded over again. That's how you opened it. And the decorators made a copy of the lid, but it's one solid piece. And then they put in modern hinges so that they opened and stayed open so the two leads could jump out. They returned the thing with the upgrade. And they were all excited about all the work they did. It looked beautiful. They did an amazing job. But the guy behind the counter scanned the barcode and said, "Gentlemen, do you still have the original lid?" And they said, "Yeah, but look at it now. It's great. Look, it opens and it stays open." Said, "Yeah, but you can restore it in the condition you found it." Said, "Yeah, but why would you want to? This is a $5,000 antique, guys. You can't upgrade an antique like this." They had no idea, which really, you know, somebody dropped the ball. Okay. Okay, I want to show you something real quick as we're driving by. There's a group called We're Going Back, and they gave this to us. The original Lion Estate gateways crumbled over time. Now remember, those things were not made to last 30 years. We're Going Back has organized Back to the Future tours for both the 25th and 30th anniversary of Back to the Future Part 1. In between the 25th and 30th, yeah, those gates just kind of fell apart. So for the 30th, they hired some prop builders to make a duplicate copy, and when the event was over, they gave that to us. It was very cool. This is New York Street, where we're a little unsure if we could see it today, but take a look at the street. It bends on both ends to create this illusion that they go on forever. The trees you can see right there are fake. If we need to on some of the roads, we could actually bring in real trees, but those look good enough for the camera. What's that? That one's toppled over? Yeah, I'm surprised that they are standing up. The winds, you can see they're going a little hard today, and they were worse overnight. Follow Owen. I'll help with some photos.
Everybody, welcome to our Metropolitan set. This is our New York Street set. It's called New York Street for short because that's more often than not what it's going to be doubling as, but it has been. We'll continue to be used for a number of locations and time periods. We've seen in London and between the 50s of the Austin Powers movies, Mike Myers. We've seen in Washington, D.C., one of my all-time favorite shows, 24, with Kiefer Sutherland. There's a car chase scene culminated right here in front of this Collins building. Suspect is chasing the vehicle into the flipping over and blowing up right here on our New York Street. Real crack in the sky. Why you want to film something like that if it's done hard, a backlog, a much more controlled filming environment. This whole area was affected by a backlog fire in 2008. When we were rebuilding it, we decided to go all out. We actually increased the overall height of the sets. But we do have some variety here. We have one style of people marked through there, up a little further, a little bit more modern. And then we do have that big glass building over there. Now, that glass building did pose a slight problem for one of the first big productions to film here, which was Captain America, the First Avenger. It was supposed to be 1940s Brooklyn. So what they did, for about the bottom two-thirds of the building, they covered it up with wood planks, make it seem like the building was under construction. The top part they covered with green industry material to fill in with the rest of the New York skyline. Take a shot with the camera looking down the road here. You're looking for the shot with Captain America just jumping on top of cars. Catch up to the bad guy, get in the way of the taxi cab. It all happened right here. This is also where Spider-Man gets unmasked in The Amazing Spider-Man with Andrew Garfield and Emma Stone. That happens right here in the center. We also have this bank right here, just called the bank, or that could be a bar. We do have some trendy bars, but it's called the library, the bank.
shop right next door as well. They're open 7 days a week. If you want to change that, change the hours, just put up a brand new sticker. It's all good. If you take a look down this street here on the left, you see that nice painted backdrop right there. Really beautifully used 3D painting technique. You do have painted reflections in those windows to cast the other side of the street. But let's face it, it is a backdrop. It's called a backdrop for a reason. It is filling in for the background. More often than not, we're focusing on what's in front of that backdrop, which is usually the actors or the props or anything like that. So it's going to be slightly out of focus anyway, but it looks gorgeous to the camera. We can change it up however we see fit. Remember, with blue or green screen material, really change it up however we see fit. About 60% of this area now is what we call practical sets, meaning you can build inside as well as outside. They're not just facades. In fact, just above the theater marquee here, the second level is a nice loft apartment set. I was lucky enough to see it fully decorated for their big grand opening of the Metro sets. And I really asked politely if I could move in, because most people should work on some of my commute helps and everything. Really, I'm just going to keep writing letters. Yeah, I wonder why you can't get a cab anywhere else. It's because they use this area for the Mindy project. But I have a feeling some of you are going to want to get your cameras ready for this next area we're about to visit.
This is Stars Hollow.
Can anyone tell me what filmed here?
Back to the Future.
Yep. That is the clock tower right there from Back to the Future. This is Hill Valley right here. Now, of course, Back to the Future deals heavily with time travel, so you don't get to see the set just as it is. You get to see it changed up drastically to reflect different time periods. The very first time you see this set is the year 1985. All of this greenery right there, the gazebo, that wasn't there. It was all blacktop asphalt. It's a parking lot for the Department of Social Services building. Then when Marty goes back to 1955, it essentially looks like it does right now, the exception being that gazebo. Where the gazebo stands now, there was a flagpole with a memorial plaque. We like the gazebo so much from the production of Ghost Whisperer that when they were striking the area, we said, leave that. We really like that. If you could leave that, that'd be great. Everything else has to go, though. Then, of course, in Back to the Future Part 2, this set took the most drastic change of all. We took it to the far distant year, 2015. Yep. Really bright, vibrant future, though. Right over here, we had the Holomax Theater playing Jaws 19. Something else we should probably catch up on. That's where the Texaco gas station was servicing some flying cars. We had a big holographic billboard just down the road by those taxi cabs saying the Chicago Cubs have won the World Series. Wouldn't that have been awesome? They were so close. That would have been awesome as a Back to the Future fan if that happened. And of course, this entire grassy area was dug up to create a body of water so that Marty can learn the hard way that hoverboards don't work on water unless you have power. We can get that boat back anytime we like. Dig the area up, fill it up with water, we're good to go. You don't even have to worry about disturbing the plant life here. The trees are real. They're just potted underneath the soil line. They can easily be removed and replaced when they're done filming. Now we can set you up with some really amazing photos, guys. Anyone like any group photos? Just pass us your cameras. Any takers?
Are you taking a picture of me and my dad?
Sure.
Where's the
gym? Oh, sorry.
No, no, it's ready. 21.
Thank you.
Just kidding. Hey, that's good job.
Valley. Yeah, that's right.
before we move on to like a future film. All right.
Of course, not just Back to the Future films here. We've had classics. We have a lot of films. Back to the
Courthouse. There's also an episode called Where Is Everybody? Man Wanders into a Small Town. Who he is or how he got there. This is the small town. They also left a big hit from a big production film there recently, just across the way there. You'll see Rocks On. That was left over from Agent Carter with Hayley Atwell. Filmed right here in Courthouse Square. Rocks On is very big in the Marvel Universe and not only was featured in Agent Carter in the background there, it was also used as a plot point in Daredevil Season 2 on Netflix.
Yeah, dude.
It's a great show. I love that show. You guys remember the movie Gremlins?
Yes!
The town of Kingston Falls right here. When the title first comes up, it's overlooking the town square here. This is the town. This is a Christmas tree lot. It took place in the wintertime. As Tony was mentioning earlier, mentioned in the park on the a bunch of fake snow set up on the ground. Also, I always like to put feelers out. Have you guys seen the movie Universal Spy Thriller called Sneakers?
Yeah.
I love that movie. The whole opening scene happens right here in Courthouse Square. He's doing some hacking there inside the building. And Ben Kingsley's character, Robert Redford's character, manages to get away because it's his turn to get beat. Flip the coin. But any questions, guys? Any photos?
How
short?
Old were you when you were
84? I was born in 84.
Ghostbusters. Yeah.
Those
Sneakers
was
one of the first hacking.
That was Sneakers was 1991.
91 too.
They were shooting in 91.
Yeah.
In 28.
Great movie though.
I recommend it one more.
Robert Redford for Jog on the Starway. And nobody recognized him.
He walked right past me on the streets of New York.
Sundance!
Jorge was directing.
And somebody handed him their camera and said,
hey, can you get a picture of this? How real the bricks are, you can go right ahead. The answer is not very. It's not very real at all. I hope they never fix this, okay? You're watching closely?
I heard the old college will park this or something.
They are.
Is it possible?
Pressing on that bubble. By the way, if we have any fans of Key and Peele, they use this little archway we're about to go back to our vehicle on as a club. Is that two skits they did with Megan and her boyfriend? Megan, your jacket!
Go!
Put it your jackets on! Really love that skit. They filmed all of the Universal for the first couple of seasons. Yeah, guys, grab it.
Got it. All right, who's next? Anybody else? Is that it? All right.
Be really quick.
Okay, yeah.
Can't go too far inside.
Awesome.
Or rock climbing or whatever, and they pass through this little town and they see that it's terrorized by a biker gang. That's Courthouse Square. The A-Team get hired to take out a corrupt sheriff who has the whole town terrorized. Welcome to Courthouse Square. Dr. David Banner, physician scientist, looking for a way to
and he's traveling all over. Yeah, he's been in Courthouse Square a couple of times. BJ and the Bear, that was Orley County. It is amazing how many times you have seen it. If you do a Google search on the square, you'll find it everywhere. Yeah. Yeah, how many times has New York Street been part of the Marvel Universe now? Captain America, Agent Carter, which is kind of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as both L.A., New York, and Berlin. Spider-Man. I mean, it's been used in Spider-Man. Well, it was both Spider-Man. So, Tobey Maguire and Andrew Garfield. Thank you. Yeah, so it is amazing that just the... And when Marvel comes, they want it to be New York according to the Marvel Universe, which might be a different New York.
Yeah.
Let's say that special episode of the Mindy Project. So everybody's got their own take on New York as well. I hope you had fun. Because, you know, Hollywood's a city, an industry, and a state of mind. So I hope you get to appreciate different aspects of the process. But we're going to shift gears and take you from where we make the movies to have you ride the movies. Now, we'd like to do this real quick because we spend a little more time in the studio than normally we would, but we were able to do so. We have the real estate to visit today. So we're going to quickly knock out three rides before you eat. Now you see my logic here, right? We're also going to be getting off this vehicle at the point furthest from the exit. So we have the Transformers ride, the Mummy, Revenge of the Mummy the ride, and Jurassic Park the ride. Now Jurassic Park's a flume, like a log ride. Ends with an 84-foot drop. You're supposed to be visiting the herbivorous section, but you wind up with carnivores, and mayhem ensues. The Mummy, you're visiting the British Museum, and you accidentally unleash the curse of the mummy's tomb, and mayhem ensues. By the way, the Mummy is a roller coaster, indoors, in this building right here. Think Space Mountain with mummies. And Transformers, you're part of an epic battle between the Autobots and the Decepticon, fighting for the Allspark, and mayhem ensues. That is a motion simulator in high-def 3D. The physical movement is not that crazy. The illusion is very crazy. So I tell you what, look around, make sure you have all your personal baggage and small children. Help yourself to bottled water in our ice chest. Let's hear it for Gilbert, because he did such a wonderful job. Let's hear it for Owen. Hey, thank you. Both groups, we're going to exit through that gate. We're going to walk about 100 feet.
Thank you.
out tonight. Is there any better way to spend a Thursday night than talking about Halloween? I am Jeff Tucker. Welcome. We're being streamed live around the globe. So welcome everybody looking and watching and thinking and hoping. And everything is going to be fantastic this year. All right, let me get through my notes here. Your patience has paid off. We're going to tell you everything. I've said that before, right? But I really mean it tonight.